Gentlemen, at this time of meeting, we're coming to order. I apologize for us being disturbed and late. That is our last session. We also, at this time, we will stand in communication with the Democratic candidates and the Federal Reserve Catholic Church. And that will be followed by the subcommittee.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we beg you to look down in kindness upon our city council and each of its members. Inspire them with the wisdom that comes from you to conduct their duties so that all citizens they govern will benefit from their leadership. As this council conducts the business of the city of Richmond, may they govern your people with fairness and justice, and may they always seek your counsel before making the hard decisions they are faced with. Open the eyes and minds of this council to your vision for our city, so that in serving the needs of their fellow citizens, they will in effect be serving you and your will in all things. We call down your blessing upon us this evening, Lord, always relying on your generous love to help us overcome whatever challenges we might face. We ask all these things, confident that you always hear us when we pray to you, our great and loving God. Amen.
Amen.
I
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Carter, please do the chamber emergency evacuation plan.
Activation of the emergency alarm system, all persons should immediately exit the building. Please use the exits to the left or right in front of the council chambers, or the east or west elevator outside the rear doors of the chamber. Do not use elevators or escalators. After exiting the building, proceed to the assembly area located in the parking lot bordered by Clay, 8th, and 9th Street. Citizens and employees should assist visually and hearing impaired visitors with exiting the field.
Thank you, Mr. Clark.
Okay. For the record, all members of council are in attendance this evening.
Thank you, sir. And at this time, would you please read the appointments and reappointments on tonight's agenda? And will all persons when your name is called and being appointed to a board commission? And then sit down just to make sure you're here. And after the papers are adopted, please meet the assistant city clerk at the rear of the chamber on my left, and she will direct you from there and administer the oath of office. And again, I want to thank all those who have volunteered to serve with the city.
Appointments and reappointments. Item number 21, resolution number 2012-R99. To appoint A. R. Howell as a member of the Sister Cities Commission. Item number 22, resolution number 2012-R19, to reappoint J. Stephen Lord Jr. as a member of the Richmond Ambulance Authority. Item number 23, resolution number 2012-R110, to reappoint Charles Winston Ellis as a member of the Board of Fire Appeals. Item number 24, resolution number 2012-R111, to appoint Jimmy Chin as a member of the DRTC and Transit Study Task Force. Item number 25, resolution number 2012-R112, to reappoint Peter Blake as a member of the Richmond Public Library Board. Item number 26, resolution number 2012-R113, to reappoint Jody Mensmore as a member of the Richmond Behavioral Health Board. Item number 28, resolution number 2012-R115, to reappoint Jody L. Peoples as a member of the Richmond Behavioral
the clerk, are there persons in the audience to speak in favor of making these appointments? In opposition? Back to council for discussion. Please call the question.
I need a motion to accept the appointment as presented. Councilman Tyler, will you make that motion?
So moved.
Council voting on tonight's agenda amendment?
I think we're voting on the appointments, reappointments.
I'm sorry, I'm voting to reappoint. Mr. Khan?
Aye.
Mr. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Hilger?
Aye.
Ms. Ramo?
Aye.
Mr. Jewell?
Aye.
Ms. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. Crown?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye.
And Ms. Grassion?
Aye.
Okay. This paper has been approved.
Then, Mr. Clerk, at this time, before we go to awards and presentations, 11 years ago tomorrow, we had a very, very tragic and horrible occurrence in the United States, and that was the terrorist attack on American soil in both New York and outside Washington. At this moment, I would like to have a moment of silence to commemorate that. Thank you, and I guess we'd be neglect if we didn't remember also all our firefighters and our police officers who served that day and did not come home at the end of the day. We want to thank our public safety officers for all the work they did. That is a very solemn note, but now I have a little bit of a happier news. Today is Councilman Jewell's birthday. Or maybe not so happy to help
me do it,
I don't know. Try to figure that out.
We got it.
All right, this time, Mr. Clerk, if we could have the awards presentations.
The first award goes to the Richmond Workforce Development Month, Ms. Kepper Wickham. Resource Workforce Investment Board. And the summary is to support, recognize, honor, and celebrate the work being done in our region on behalf of Workforce Development and proclaim the month of September 2012 as Richmond Workforce Development.
Let's give them a round of applause.
skills in order to be able to support businesses here in the community. And we know that with that support, our economy is going to grow and that all citizens in our region are going to be able to benefit. So we thank you very much for your support and hope that we will see all of you at our grand opening of our new bus stop. It's going to be on September the 24th at 1:30. We'd love to see you there. Well, thank you so much. 121 Cedar Road is the location that you will be getting invitations. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, the next award is being presented by the mayor and council to Richmond Infant Mortality Awareness Month. To support, recognize, and honor, and celebrate the work and accomplishments being achieved on behalf of lowering infant mortality rates in our community and proclaim the month of September 2012 as Richmond Infant Mortality Awareness Month. This goes to the Richmond official joint, it is an organization.
Well, this is one that we do with mixed emotions because every year we lose infants unnecessarily in the city of Richmond. And we recognize that to get on this list means that infants don't make their first birthday, so that's not good news. And the good news, the bad news is that we have been tremendously high on this list for many years, but we're very happy to report that our numbers have gone down. Yet we have so much work to do in this regard. So we thank you for what you're doing. We have programs like the Blue Ribbon Commission, Breastfeeding and Food Policy Commissions, and the Health District's Resource Mothers work. All of these things are working toward making this a better situation, but we have much work to do. So we thank you for what you're doing as we make this proclamation today.
Again, I'd just like to piggyback on what the mayor said. Thank you for all your hard work. I see the numbers increasing. Part of that is the care of us, part of that is awareness and education, which you are giving to the entire community. If mothers are well, they take care of themselves, chances are those babies are going to fall too. So we just want to thank you very much for what you do.
President Graziano, council members, we're very pleased to work together with you for Healthier Richmond. There are many variables that have contributed to the reduction in mortality in Richmond. And though we'd like to stand here and really stick out our chests and say, aren't we wonderful? What we really like to acknowledge is the partnerships that have been created here in Richmond and the surrounding region to improve the outcomes of pregnancy. And a big part of that has been through the Richmond Healthy Start Initiative through the Department of Social Services. There are three major areas that really impact the well-being of mothers and their babies. Part of it is what they bring to their pregnancy. So women who are healthy, entry pregnancy, overweight, their diabetes is under control, healthy relationships, they're more likely to have healthy outcomes. The second time period is what happens during the pregnancy. Entering into prenatal care early and continuing prenatal care, identifying medical conditions that might impact the pregnancy outcome is very important and valuable. And there's the third time period, and that is what happens to that baby after its birth. Mary noted that infant death is that time period between the child's birth and their first birthday. Yes, we have some progress, but we made significant progress. The 8.4 infant mortality rate for Richmond this past year is probably, and I qualify it probably, the lowest infant mortality rate in the city's history. We've gone back 20 years and looked at the data. I'm pretty confident that if we looked at Richmond's prior history, infant mortality rates were even higher. But we've got some progress yet to make. There's a wide disparity in health outcomes in regards to racial outcomes. The African-American infant mortality rate is still twice as high, and it's one of the goals of the Healthy Start Initiative is to reduce that gap. What we did notice in this last year was that sudden death syndromes, we had no sudden deaths this past year. And we worked real hard at the Back to Sleep campaign. We also noticed that extreme prematurity is pretty much absent this other school summit. There was a significant reduction in extreme prematurity. That's those babies that are born less than 5 pounds. And I must really emphasize this because I think it's substantial. That is a reduction in teen pregnancies in Richmond City. When you have a 30% reduction in teen pregnancies, with an associated reduction in teen live births, with an associated reduction in teen infant deaths, because they're at higher risk for having a infant death, we're making some substantial progress across the board in improving the health of the community. So, thank you for acknowledging this, for recognizing this month. We wish the public, you know, it's what women do in regards to their health that really improve pregnancy outcomes, and we appreciate your acknowledgement. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Madam President, members of council, Mr. Mayor. We would like to thank you for this recognition. As Dr. Stern has indicated, it's a partnership, and without the work of the other partners that we have, we would not be able to accomplish this. So we would like to thank you for this recognition.
And at this time, I would like to acknowledge some of those partners, in particular our Community Advisory Board, which is about 40-member board, but only about 6 were able to make it, and I'd not like them to stand. Public Council presidents, public housing residents, and they really help us get the message into the target population that we try to work so hard to improve. But I would be remiss if I didn't just quickly try to acknowledge a few other members of Richmond Behavioral Health Authority. The three health systems come to the table with Healthy Start and with the health department, ECU, Foster Schools, and ACA, our home visiting programs, Chair of Healthy Families, the VCU Center on Health Disparities, and it's a group of diverse groups. It's not just all healthcare professionals. We have Commonwealth Catholic Charities, Richmond Redevelopment and Housing, the Christian Counseling and Training Center, the Hilltop Promise, United Way, This Is Your Birth. So it's really this very diverse group in which everyone brings something to the table to help us address this problem. And we do want to acknowledge those partnerships and all. Thank you.
It involves your work and it involves the work of the person who has the dish. It's a lifelong struggle. We really appreciate all you do to get people to be able to function as normal adults, or pretty normal adults, in the society in which they live. Without your help, they can't. So I just want to thank you very much.
I just want to add my voice to thank you for providing treatment to all those who are in recovery. We know that there are just numerous persons and families who are affected by this. We also know that this is a condition that does not discriminate, that it goes from the good neighborhoods to the neighborhoods that may not be considered good. And we recognize that this is something that we cannot hide our heads in the sand, that we've got to stand up to this and face it. You do a lot to help us with that. And so for your work in awareness and creating awareness, we thank you, and for all that you do to help those persons who are really trying to pull themselves up and out of their addictions, we're very appreciative. Thank you so much.
Madam President, members of the Council, Mr. Mayor, I just want to thank you for recognizing the Richmond, the Area Health Authority, for being more than just a safety net for not only the city of Richmond, but also for the region. We have had the support, unequivocal support, of the council and the administration for a number of years. As you know, we touch the lives of about 5% of all of the residents of the city of Richmond, and we continue to do that, provide services beyond much of the finance capability of the authority. And I just want to say on behalf of our 15-member board, of which Dr. Newville is one of our members, I want to say again, we really appreciate all the support. Our board chair cannot be here this evening, but we do have a couple of our board members here, Dr. Napoleon Peoples, who's just been reappointed to the board, and also Mr. William Sharpe. So I'm going to ask Dr. Peoples, on behalf of our 15-member board, just to give you a brief appreciation and acknowledgement of the 15-member board.
Madam Graziano, members of the board, Mayor Jones, I really want to appreciate, as a board member, all that you've done for us. It's a group that's really worked hard to bring some sort of parity in terms of drug and alcohol, change the climate here in Richmond. I really appreciate it. Members of the board, and I said we really appreciate all that you've done for us. Thank you. I see some who voted more than once. But we want to thank all those who voted
accept this wonderful achievement, and now the world knows we are all here, Rich and Marty.
And I just have to echo what the mayor has said. In case nobody knows it, Richmond had more votes than the next five cities combined. So we had a very active Facebook crowd in Richmond and a very active Facebook crowd that loves the river. And I give credit to the mayor. Now we have a riverfront plan. When I first moved to Richmond in 1969, it was a James River Park, but I don't think anybody on the city council even knew that park existed. And today, it's, as the mayor says, it's a jewel and a gem. And not only does it provide life quality for our citizens, it's an economic driver as well. So we are just so excited to be the best river town in the country, and I hope we all go to the river this weekend. Okay. And congratulations on that.
Okay, next we have an official dedication. This is in reference to Richmond City Council Chambers' seat dedication honoring Ms. Ruby Ethel Giles Turner. To officially designate and dedicate the first seat in Richmond City Council Chambers to Ms. Ruby Ethel Giles Turner, and will commemorate this action with the placement of a permanent plaque with her name on its recognition, honor, celebration, and remembrance of her lifelong dedication to public government and community service, and for her commitment to helping make the Richmond, making the entire Richmond area an even better and safer place to live, work, learn, love, play, visit, and raise a family.
Okay. It gives us great pleasure to be able to give this honor posthumously to Ms. Turner. All of us knew her, all of us loved her. She made an impact throughout the city and the region. She was not shy by a long shot. She said what she meant, and she meant what she said, and she said it to people whether they liked it or not. I appreciated that about her. And this was her place. We knew that when she was here in that seat, that it was game on. And so now, with this plaque, forever it will be memorialized that she played such a vital role in the history of the city of Richmond. And so we say peace to her ashes and rest her soul.
Thank you. And we on council miss her not only for all the interaction that we had with her, but to have her see her sitting in that seat every 2 weeks and hear her do the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I miss that. I think we all miss that. And I just want to read, she was a wonderful lady, and I'm sorry for her loss. But we've never, ever in the history of City Council since 1782, I guess, huh? had a plaque on a seat that we know. So now this says, in honor and remembrance, this first seat in Richmond City Council Chambers is dedicated in honor and remembrance of Ms. Ruby Ethel Giles Turner. And so we will keep it there, we'll keep it in our hearts. We're going to pass a resolution tonight that dedicates that seat to her so that 50 years from now, nobody can say this is the first, because they'll see a resolution that the first was Ruby Turner. So thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for sharing that with us.
Yeah, it is.
Thank you, Mayor Jones, President Graziano, Councilman Connor, all other members of the council. Truly, this is an honor. Honor that I am ever so graciously and humbled by to receive on behalf of my mother. I was sharing this with my co-workers back in Hawaii, and I said to them, you know, I said, it's just awesome how when
when you do community service, your deeds are rewarded openly. Because what you do in the dark comes to light. What you do in the light stays in the light. And I thank God for my mom being an active member and participating in the community, because she was one of service. And she was always one who wanted to ensure that her city was taken care of in so many, many ways. And I just want to thank you all so very, very much for this honor. And I hope that there is a tape that I can take back to Hawaii with me, so I can put it on everybody's computer. So thank you all so very, very much again.
Yes.
2012, well, when it's number three, when it comes down to children. Also, I have a position of paper for council that I'm in. We oppose the ordinance, specifically the parking situation. Our parking lot, we share with the owners of the multi-family dwelling. We believe that will be a problem because we've been using that parking lot for the entire time that we've been at that building. There's never been a sign or any restriction on our parking there. The applicant for the ordinance cited the density, population density of the neighborhood that would change from weekday to weekend to, I think, evenings. And specifically evenings and weekends, weekends more so, is when we rent our building as a banquet facility. Recently did considerable renovations to the building to bring it up to ADA code that we licensed by the city to operate as a banquet hall. And we're afraid that if this ordinance is approved, that we would no longer be able to do business at that location.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam President.
Mr. Chairman.
Well, Commissioner Leeds, ma'am, are you saying that you all received no notice prior to any of this?
The notice that we did receive, we responded to. I went and spoke to the planning commission and registered our opposition. I believe the president was at the last meeting. I know the president was at the last meeting.
So, you all don't own the parking lot?
Three different, the parking lot is owned by three different entities.
Does it belong, any part of it belong to your group?
Yes, we own that part of the parking lot that is immediately adjacent to our building. The applicant would, he actually owns the center of the parking lot, and then there's a third on the corner. I think the address is 3108. They own that part of the parking lot that is immediately adjacent to their building. So we have three entities that actually have to coexist with that one parking lot.
And you don't lease any additional beyond what you own?
We've been using it.
No, do you have a lease on anything?
No. We just always. Well, put it this way, we just never had any encumbrance to our using it, so I don't think anybody even needed, we didn't own it, because every month we have a union meeting, we park there, we have banquets, we park there. It fills up pretty fast, so that's why we opposed it. We are not trying to stay in the progress, but we just know we see a problem in the future with possibly the development, now realizing that the office building that is next door turns into a bank hall on the weekend. The tenants, prospective tenants, may not be aware, so that would lead me to a problem.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you,
Madam President.
May I ask you with this?
Ms., can you repeat your name again, please?
Dwan is Sterling.
Saturday.
Dwan.
Okay.
D-W-A-N.
Okay.
L. Mm-hmm. Sterling. S-T-U-R-T-E-D-A-N-T.
Good evening. My name is Silver Persinger. I'm not speaking on the consent agenda. I am bringing an order of process.
while since I've attended a meeting, but the usual custom is to read the items on the consent agenda, which you all are voting upon. That is for the benefit of the television audience and people who are not able to read that may be sitting in the audience that have an opinion. I will sit back down and I hope that this consent agenda is read and then public comments are solicited after the consent agenda is read. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. You are absolutely correct.
Yes, ma'am. Consent agenda items consist of the following. Number 2, ordinance number 2012-92, to amend city code for the purpose of increasing penalties for dog owners with multiple violations within a 24-month period. Number 3, ordinance 2012-101, to authorize the special use of 3110 and 3122 West Clay Street for a multi-family dwelling and an accessory parking area. Number 4, ordinance 2012-111, to accept $14,000 from the Virginia Office of the Attorney General for the purpose of reducing gang activity in targeted neighborhoods. Item 5, ordinance number 2012-112, to exempt 1301 Wakemore Road for real property taxation for 2012. Item 6, ordinance number 2012-113, to exempt 48 West Colton Street for real property taxation for 2012. Item 7, ordinance number 2012-114, to exempt 2307 Hall Street Road for real property taxation for 2012. Item 8, ordinance number 2012-120, to exempt 1517 Jefferson Davis Highway from real property taxation for 2012. Item 9, ordinance number 2012-122, to exempt 2023 West Cary Street from real property taxation for 2012. Item 10, ordinance number 2012-123, to exempt 2123 West Cary Street from real property taxation for 2012. Item 11, ordinance number 2012-125, to exempt 2504 3rd Avenue from real property taxation for 2012. Item 12, ordinance number 2012-126, to exempt 2908 West Cary Street from real property taxation for 2012. Item 13, ordinance number 2012-128, to exempt 2925 3rd Avenue from real property taxation for 2012. Item 14, ordinance number 2012-132, to exempt 3030 Meadowbridge Road for real property taxation for 2012. Item number 15, ordinance number 2012-133, to exempt 4909 Chamberlain Avenue for real property taxation for 2012. Item 16, to exempt 6117 Valley Road for real property taxation for 2012. Item 17, ordinance number 2012-137, to exempt 929 North 26th Street from real property taxation for 2012. Item 18, ordinance number 2012-157, to authorize the special use of 930 Terminal Place and a portion of 950 Terminal Place for a multi-family dwelling. Item 20, resolution number 2012-R89, to amend resolution number 2012-R20-70 for the purpose of changing the name of the Health, Human Services, and Education Standing Committee to the Education and Human Services Standing Committee. Madam President, this completes the consent agenda.
Thank you, Burke. Since we have any other people here speak in opposition to these papers? Okay. Are the people here speak in favor of any papers on the consent agenda?
Good evening, my name is Silver Bursinger, I'm an assistant in Richmond, Virginia. I'd like to speak in favor of item 20 to rename the Health and Human Services and Education Standing Committee to the Education and Human Services Committee. I think it's good to put education ahead in the committee. It accounts for 25% of our city's budget. And before the at-large mayor form of government, there used to be an education committee. That's all it did. It was last chaired by Jackie Jackson, and it's very common for members of the school board and the superintendent to attend those meetings. I have another clarification. agenda, merely accepting the address and that it was, that council seeking to exempt these properties. She neglected to mention the entities which are printed on the sheet, which, you know, this is brief enough, but you know, the entities are Carey Street Defund LLC, Chestnut Hill Apartments LLC, Bird Theater Foundation, Cherokee Hill of Richmond Incorporated, Boaz and Ruth Fine Incorporated, Bladley Manor, Friends East End Daycare. Now, that's not all of them, but I'm making a point. This is something the clerk's office should be reading to the public. And finally, I would like to raise a question about this terminal place. What that is the Intervake factory that is going to be turned into 187 apartments. And my question to the council is, does it make a difference that you all renamed Terminal Place Imagination Lane a few years ago? Thank you for the opportunity to comment.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Good evening. My name is Peggy Karen, and I'm speaking for We the People. Number 14, we're asking that Boaz and Ruth not be given their tax exempt status until the investigation is over. There is an ongoing investigation and criminal allegations made against this company, and we don't feel that they should have that status until the complete investigation is over.
Thank you. Opposition? You're in opposition?
In support.
Then we're going to call support now. I'm going to get to the opposition. Okay, is there anyone else who wants to speak in opposition to any of these papers? Okay, support of any of these papers. Now up to support.
Madam President, Madam Vice President, and I'm here to speak in support of item number 3, ordinance number 2012-101, regarding 3110 and 3122 West Clay Street. I recommend the dwelling. There were some comments made, and I would like to clarify, first of all, that.
Can you bring your microphone up?
I would like to clarify that the parking lot that is subject to this special use permit is owned by the applicant. There is nothing occurring on any property that the applicant does not own. And the proposed parking we have is 17 spots for 17. Any other questions that any members have with respect to this particular project?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Paul Hammond, and I am formerly of the 2nd District, and I'm currently now in the 6th District. Looking forward to speaking up in this purpose in the future. I just would like to request, for my own personal benefit and for the benefit of the people watching and the public in general, if you could just speak for a few minutes on the purpose of all these tax exemptions. Most people have no idea, and I don't, why you're doing this. I mean, with perfectly good reasons, or not, but we'd like to kind of hear a brief. I would like to hear a brief explanation, if possible.
Okay. Thank you. Any other comments? In favor of any papers? All right, just to address this, there are certain designations of tax exemption that the state puts out on churches, hospitals, schools, I think. Then it's up to each locality as to whether or not they will grant tax-exempt status to certain nonprofits. who perform certain services for the community. We had Ms. Gibberton for many years granted tax exempt nonprofits about 3 or 4 years ago. We put a moratorium on that tax exemption. This year, we lifted the moratorium, accepted applications for the tax exempt status. Various groups applied for that tax exempt. Those applications first went to a committee. The committee looked at them and determined which ones they thought should get tax exempt status based on criteria. Those papers, all of them went to council, who looked at them again and determined, and that's what's on the regular agenda, those that all members of council felt met the criteria for tax exempt status, and those that council had questions about or that the committee had turned down on the regular agenda, and those that who meet the criteria for tax exempt status are on the consent agenda. Okay. All right.
Madam President?
Yes, sir.
You ready to bring it back to council?
I am.
I just wanted to make, in reference to the gentleman's question, there are a lot of reasons why I think it's a prudent thing to do to provide tax exemptions for these nonprofits. I need to preface it by saying that I started off only trying to get exemption for the Bird Theater. I think by all accounts, everybody in town thinks that that's a historic gem that needs saving. It's struggling financially. It needs a ton of work with regards to renovation and restoration. But God forbid if the light should go out in that marvelous gem. So that's the first thing. The other is that, you know, there are a lot of nonprofits that are struggling in this god-awful economy. Three and a half years we've been in this ditch. And each year, the pain is more and more excruciating for us as individuals and for these nonprofits who struggle on a good day. Moreover, we lost population during the 80s and the 90s. We had white flight, and then later we had black flight. We were down 193,000 people in this city. Corporate disinvested in this city and redeployed their investments out of the county. So the city was poor. We struggled back, and by God's providence, we've recovered and are now at 204,000 people. 11,000 additional people to broaden the tax base. And I don't think that the city is hurting financially at all. Praise the Lord. Unprecedented amount of money we put in the rainy day fund. $15 million that we failed to even recognize to build and collect for commercial and real estate personal property tax until the auditor found it. Come on, y'all. That's going to show up as a bonus to us because it's not going to reflect in the city's revenue stream in our budget this year. It was found after the budget was given to us. So, I mean, the $62 million that we just got from the RMA, they're all, we're in Fat City, man. And so we're not hurting, I know we're not going to begrudge 24 not-for-profits struggling over $160,000 combined. It's outrageous and it's penny-wise and pound foolish. Last point is that most of these organizations, almost all profits, in their IRS 501c3 application insert a commitment to relieve the
of government, otherwise we'd have to do it. They're fighting to house people who've been re-entered from incarceration. Nobody else would do it. Housing homeless people, nobody else would do it. And finding a way to get it done while in the group home situation with Boaz and Ruth, that they're actually cleaning up neighborhoods as they clean up these properties, providing work opportunities for the very people who live in them. So, no, this is an easy call for me. The gentleman still needs to know. And I'm just hopeful that my colleagues see it that way. While I have the floor, Madam Chairman, I'm going to vote no on number three. And I need to explain number 19. I am withdrawing the paper having to do with changing of the overflow homeless shelter regulation that takes the temperature from 35 degrees to 40 degrees before it triggers it being opening on these cold nights, having to take into consideration wind chill. I am withdrawing this paper because we are reintroducing a new paper that will address all of the pertinent points. So anyone see that withdrawal, don't panic. Another one's on its way. Thank you. Just number 19.
Thank you, Mr. Jewell. Other comments on the consent agenda, Ms. Carroll?
Thank you, Madam President. Mark, I'd like to thank you for your comments tonight, and also I want to make sure that we get the word out that it's not too late for others to apply for this, because I think, as far as there are so many organizations that are operating right now, nonprofits, trying to get different things from different companies to help not only some of the residents in the 8th District, but the South Side, but probably all of the city, because at this time right now, there are needs. I mean, needs that people are just begging for food, begging for clothes, begging for jobs. So I want to definitely make sure that we get the word out. This is just not only for this. We're going to ask more people to help out. So I'm going to support this paper. Now, with these papers, sorry.
Thank you, Madam President. I do have to agree with my colleague, Ms. Jewell. Sometimes being penny-wise does actually end up being a pound foolish. 5 years ago, when I first came to City Council, we had this discussion about nonprofits. And I, in fact, voted for the paper to actually stop allowing nonprofits to be able to get tax exemptions. Several years after the fact, I realized it was a mistake. And so I began the process trying to figure out a way to bring it back to council. First, I was looking for partial exemptions, but realized that it would take an act of General Assembly plus the citizens of the Commonwealth would have to vote on it. And so we moved away from the partial tax exemptions. At the same time, I began to see organizations like Boaz and Ruth who had come on the scene and were carrying the burden of having to pay city taxes. And I know how hard it is, Mr. Jewell alluded to, I know how hard it is to raise funds for nonprofit organizations. I've done it in the past and I will do it in the future. But at the end of the day, every dollar counts. Folks that normally run these nonprofit organizations actually are providing a service that if they did not provide it, then the city of Richmond would be picking up that burden. So for the nonprofits in the city of Richmond who come in here every day and work on our behalf, I want to say thank you. But I also want to broaden the picture a little bit here because I've had a lot of citizens email me and ask me questions about this whole tax exempt issue. Some of my colleagues, I believe, have commented that the floodgates are going to open and we're going to have more and more folks at the door, and as a result, we're going to have a situation that's unmanageable. First of all, the city of Richmond does bear the burden
not exact numbers, but rough numbers, $5.7 billion in real estate is exempt, assessed value is exempt in the city of Richmond. Of that, Commonwealth of Virginia has the honor of about $2.6 billion, that is exempt or partial. They pay a pile. Actually, $1.6 billion is exempt, which means we receive not the first nickel. So when you look at the big numbers, you get $5.75 billion. You realize the Commonwealth of Virginia comes at the top of the list. City of Richmond has over $1 billion worth of property that's exempt, almost $1.5 billion. Other government entities like Henrico County, Chesterfield, United States of America has about $415 million. Religious organizations has about $427 million worth of exemptions. Educational facilities in the city, $378 million. And then we finally get down to nonprofit organizations, $241 million. That's how much we've exempted in the past. And these are numbers that were given to me by one of our staff members several years ago, so they've been updated a little bit. But you get the flavor, and you get the understanding that we're sitting here and we're talking about potentially adding $16 million worth of taxes and property to the rolls in comparison to $5.7 billion. I don't believe the floodgates are open. I believe we are doing the prudent thing by allowing these papers to be passed. But I want to frame this in a broader sense because a lot of folks thought that this had never been done before because since they had been in the city of Richmond, they had not heard that. But at the end of the day, I will take the $195,000 in tax exemptions that we are granting roughly tonight and thank the folks that are here working on our behalf. I think it's a small price for us to pay to receive such benefit to our community. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Bauer. Other comments? Mr. Cooper.
This has been a difficult issue. I do think that we have spent an inordinate amount of time on this. I stand by my earlier comments about this, and I feel like that this is subject to review, although it can be a confusing review. These organizations do great work. Very clear about that. These organizations work very hard, and that's where I think the line starts to get a little nebulous as to who is doing quote unquote good work and who might not be, and the various causes that they promote. And it seemed to me that as a governmental entity, we'd like to treat everybody as equals. Some of these organizations do get other city funding. I think this gets down to who's going to put in the time and effort to make these applications. I've stated and we'll follow through on reinstituting this moratorium on this policy. I just had difficulty with the way it was implemented. However, I will say that the organizations I voted against lifting this moratorium. I want to keep it in place. But having been outvoted on that, I wanted to follow the process for the organizations that did make applications. And other organizations, or many organizations, did apply. They were ones that were recommended by both the committee as well as the committee recommended a few organizations and council as a whole approved others. It's difficult for me to vote for any of the organizations on the regular agenda given that they were not supported in the council committee meeting. However, I'm troubled that while we've got $214 million, as Mr. Tyler indicated, that's $214 million that huge dollar amount relative to $5.8 billion, but the Commonwealth exempted itself from these taxes. And this is typical of the General Assembly to allow localities to give tax exemptions, and they'll pass all the tax exemptions across the street, as we say, because all the impact is on local government. But I don't see the Commonwealth taking a stand where it impedes its own revenue. And that is very troubling, and it's something that's happened time and time again, over again, regardless of the political party that's in charge of the General Assembly. And I suspect that we can anticipate a lot more of this in the next year, of more costs coming down on local governments, and we continue to chip away at this. So I did want to let you know that I will be reintroducing this this moratorium, and I hope that, we won't be having these meetings from time to time that, really start to, add up. I stand by my earlier comments on that, and ask for future support for reinstituting this moratorium. Thank you, Madam President.
Madam President.
Thank you, Ms. Kehover. Would see if anybody else has anything to say. Mr. Sanders.
Thank you. I'm voting in favor of these papers. I believe the organizations do good work and also meet the mandated criteria for receiving this tax exemption. I think most of the nonprofits in town, regardless of whether or not they meet the criteria, could stand to save a couple of dollars. I wish we could do it for every single nonprofit in town. But these are the nonprofits who apply who do meet the criteria, and I will be supporting them. I hear what Mr. Tyler is saying, I hear what Mr. Hilbert is saying. I think there is some work we need to do to make sure that we are equitable in this, but tonight we did good work, and I'm thrilled that these organizations are going to have a little extra money to do their work.
Thank you.
I'm
going to let everybody go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I actually will support the ones presented this evening because we did train these. We talked about these. The committee came to us and approved these ahead of time. We screened them and we added a couple to it. The ones on the regular agenda, I do not feel like I can support because we did not have our due diligence. We talked about getting more information that we could, use to decide which ones were the good ones and which ones were not quite as good. So on the second round of the tax exemptions, I will vote against those until we get more information.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Connor. Thank you, Madam President. I did much of what's been said by my colleagues in terms of the work that's done throughout our city by the nonprofit organizations that are before us in this video. And would just like to say that the papers that are on consent agenda will be voting in favor of, as I do believe that the organizations, as we all know, and as has been said already, certainly these are tough economic times for all, and that burden is borne and felt by nonprofits. Who provide invaluable services to our communities that, as we've indicated before, were they not there, the city in many instances might pick up and or that the services would go unaddressed. And so I want to recognize them and appreciate all of them who are here, some of whom I see, some I can't see, but there are many of you, and I will certainly would be remiss. We don't have very many child care. We do not have very many quality child care facilities in our community. I would be remiss if I didn't mention Friends East End Daycare Center that here can provide an extraordinary service to our children, which becomes critical when you're talking about providing support services for families who are seeking employment and so forth. So I want to say thank you to them especially, but thank you to all of the organizations that are part of this OS group and many others who have gone through the list. And as I indicated from, which was a little long-winded, Madam President, I will be voting in favor of these papers.
Thank you.
I will be joined by Mr. Dewar and on the continuation of accepting applications for tax exemption. I have a very kindred spirit for nonprofits, which works what they do, and is most valuable. However, I don't think that we have done the work that we need to do to receive the applications and to properly evaluate applications. I think that the applications that are on the consent agenda have had significant discussion. The ones that are on the regular agenda were not voted against by the council. There was some additional information that was requested. However, I feel that if we're going to make a recommendation outside of the recommendation of the committee that was responsible for making recommendations to us, without looking at any additional information on those that we're supporting, then I think it's fair that we give all of these nonprofits that we know of legitimate nonprofits that are doing a great job a second opportunity. And for the council to go back and complete the work that it needs to do to put together an evaluation system, that whereas the committee makes a recommendation to us, is comprehensive and supportive, that we will not have to make a decision in the absence of that information. With that, Madam President, I will support the consent as well as the report.
Thank you, Mr. Robinson. And Mr. Dewar, you had an additional comment?
Yes. Mr. That guy right there. That handsome guy right there. Mr. President, I'm sorry. Brought to our attention the glaring omission earlier with regards to having to read off this consent agenda. He also brings us a pretty important piece that we may have overlooked as well with regards to these papers, and I'm referring to item number 18, where 950 Terminal Place. I'm thinking Terminal Place is somewhere in your district, Ms. Trammell, and he just educated me that that's back over past the Science Museum, where the old Innovate cooking manufacturing place was, and is now being converted into 178 dwelling units, meaning apartments in this economic environment. Certainly not condos. But I'm curious to know what this is about. Is there anyone from administration who can educate us as to what this is? Because I don't think it fits into any of the other types of entities that we're about to vote on. Does anybody else have heartburn about this?
Madam President, may I address that?
Please.
Mr. Jewell, that's a special use permit. It's not one of the exemption papers. It's the They don't want the additional special treatment besides getting their SBA.
See what happens when you go to night school.
Yeah, it's your birthday.
It's my birthday right there. I could be dumb if I were. Sylvia, you set me up, Sylvia.
Oh, the street name changed.
Mr. Burke, just call the question.
Council is voting on tonight's consent agenda items as presented. Mr. Conner?
Aye.
Mr. Samuels?
Aye.
Mr. Hilbert?
Aye.
Madam Vice President Robertson?
Aye.
Mr. Jewell?
Aye, except item 3.
Ms. Newville?
Aye.
Ms. Trammell?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye.
Madam President Graziano?
Aye.
Those items have been adopted.
Thank you, Madam President. This time, may you please have some comment?
He's not here. The next speaker, we have Eddie Hinton. Eddie Hinton.
Madam President, councilmen, my name is Eddie Hinton. I'm here to speak on behalf of Human Health and the Richmond City Jails and the legal system here in Richmond. As Sheriff Wood have often said, that mentally ill people need to mental care. They need facilities there in place for them to go. They also do not need to be put in jail when they get off their medication. We need these city policemen, DCU policemen, to be trained to identify these issues when these people have problems and get off their medication. We also need more intervention and communication between the different services, social services, behavioral services, as well as these inspectors that inspect the homes and the facilities that they live in. I have been in several facilities and seen bed bugs, broken down beds, licenses that have been rejected, but they still exist. People living in those facilities that need to go to the MCB or to their doctors who don't get care, I have to get up and walk to get medical care. I've seen this. Things need to be in place to help these people and assist them with their problems. When someone gets off the medication, you find that, another quote from Sheriff Woody, the police officer will arrest them and have them locked up. It's a lot easier to have them detained than to call crisis intervention or help to assist. These people also need to be trained to identify these problems and give them the help that they need instead of having them locked up. You have people just locked up in the jails right now who are not cannot make bail behind mental health issues. When you address these problems with the city courts, then you are there complaining or either causing disturbances when you're only making an observation. These are some of the things that I have experienced with my son and with the different entities around Richmond supposed to help and assist. You can call social workers, you can call the case managers, and their thing is, I don't do this, this is my job. You can call another entity, they are not communicate internally in the facility that they are, nor in the surrounding counties, that when you run into a problem. So how do you resolve these problems? I mean, then there's budgeting. There's not enough money that's going into the system to help these people. These people are human beings. These people cannot advocate for themselves. And I'm calling upon the city council tonight to look deeper into this. I mean, rejected licenses. I mean, in better places.
Your time is up. Thank you.
Can you finish?
Pardon me? As a guy, you finish your sentence, because you have 2 minutes, so finish your thought there.
Well, I just would like to see more assistance, more financial assistance come available to give assistance so we can help do something to eradicate or at least resolve some of the issues that exist. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank
you.
Council President,
Mr. Hendricks. I'd like to thank you for coming here tonight and supporting this for our country, and also to let you know that I've been working hand in hand with social service here in the city, and I've seen a lot of great things with Dr. Graham, with Carla Wesley, with Greg Jones, Paul Manning, and it looks like, you know, there needs to be more people hired to maybe that position, whatever, to help us. And also, we need the community to let us know if there's someone in the neighborhood who needs care, because just last week I met someone and I had no idea that she needed some care. She didn't even have a television working or a phone working. And I know that social service here is reaching out to help her. And the first thing she said, she was afraid to let somebody know because she was afraid that somebody would put her in a home or something and she didn't want to lose her home. So a lot of times people will reach out because they're afraid what might happen to her. So I think that maybe we need some better education to let them know that if you reach out to us, it's not going to take you out of your home, take you away from community family members and things like that. And I want to say thank you for bringing this care to you. And maybe, I know that we've had this discussion with the police officers and with the police and with Sheriff's Security that it's not locking someone up that has mental illness. That's not considered to have. And I know that Mayor Jones, with the new jail that's being built, it's going to be not for, you know, people that have mental illness and things like that. They go into another public place to get the treatment that they need. But again, thank you for this question.
Thank you. That held 10 seconds. I just always hear this term that the ball was dropped or the city fell. Someone, I would not like to see this city fail someone or mental health fail someone.
Madam President.
Yes,
sir. Mr. Henry, before you leave, I gave you my card. Truth be told, a city this size, a bureaucracy this size, people fall through the cracks every day. I get the call, we all get the call. And that's why we're here. Lynn Trammell chairs the Public Safety Committee. I know it was reported in that committee that police chief was training a cadre of police officers to address mental illness issues as they encounter them on patrol and out the street. If it's anything as bad as you're suggesting, then that ain't working. And maybe we need to do something else, get the chief out before we can do the better, apply some help where help is needed. But I know what you're talking about because I go through it regularly. I would love to learn where those facilities that you're talking about that have been delicensed. And we'll talk. But we appreciate you coming in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next speaker is Diane Tucker. Next speaker is Laura Kuhnman.
It's hard to follow that.
Madam President, Madam Vice President, members of council, thank you for letting me have the opportunity to speak to you tonight. I'm here as representative of the Alliance for Progressive Values, and we support allowing residents of the city of Richmond and surrounding counties to keep reasonable number of poultry laying hens on their property for the purpose of providing fresh eggs. As part of our larger efforts to promote a more sustainable urban environment, the APB supports the reintroduction of privately owned livestock in suitable numbers to urban settings. In particular, we believe that bringing laying hens back to the city will foster a closer relationship between residents and the food they consume. There are many obvious benefits to allowing city residents to keep laying hens, but as the Marno family just pointed out, free-range chickens' eggs are healthier, with up to two-thirds less cholesterol than conventional eggs, and more vitamins and omega-3 fatty acids. Our city is developing a sustainable food policy. Allowing citizens to raise a healthier source of nutrition is a big step in the right direction. As an added benefit, letting chickens roam our yards can also cut down on insect pests, and after this year's onslaught of inchworms and Japanese beetles and mosquitoes, I'm all in favor of that. New York City, Boston, Austin, Texas, Portland, Oregon, and Madison, Wisconsin are just a few of the U.S. cities that allow urban poultry within their limits. Our current zoning allows chickens on city lots that have 50,000 square feet or greater, which makes it all but impossible for the majority of Richmond residents to keep hens. We encourage the City of Richmond to change the ordinance and allow residents to keep a reasonable number of laying hens in their backyards. Thank you very much. Thank you. Mr. Kirk, that is at the end of the board comment.
The next speaker is Valerie West.
Hi, my name is Valerie West, and I'm in the first district of Richmond City. I'll be brief. I'm here for urban health. You've seen me before, you'll probably see me again. First, I'd like to thank Keith Rogers for the amazing report he gave today. It obviously required a lot of research, talking to a lot of people, both for and against urban hens, and he really put together something great, I believe. A couple of things I did want to address, that I think a $60 per year permit is a little high. For a dog, you only pay $10 per year. There was also another question about other locales in Virginia and how much distance they require for people that have pets to their neighbors or to neighboring dwellings. I'd like to hold up Charlottesville as one of the nicest places to live in the United States and, besides Richmond, of course, and a locale that requires no distance buffer. They rely on their neighbors being good neighbors. Of course, they also allow roosters, which is something we don't want. I did want to address something that Reva had mentioned about dogs running loose and roosters being a problem. We completely agree. Roosters, we don't want them here, they make noise. We just want laying hens. And we don't want animal control out there citing responsible hen owners when they could be chasing the loose dog. You know, there's people, we're trying to decriminalize the people who are already responsibly keeping hens. And I'm really happy to see, I think we're all kind of in the same page, going in the same direction. We just have a few things to work out. And I guess when we first started talking to our council representatives last fall on a regular basis, and I'm hoping we can expedite this through, and we're not here next next fall, still discussing the particulars, and we all seem to agree it's probably a pretty good idea. Any questions about chickens? Would anyone like one of our information sheets on chickens that compares decibels of noise that chickens make versus the waste they produce to other animals? There should be one for everybody. And also the Pat Forman lecture, the expert on urban hens and how we can change the world through chickens. Unfortunately, I guess everyone had alternate plans that night and couldn't come. But I did buy her book, if anyone would like to borrow her book. Thank you for the RSVP, Kat Krajan. Would anyone like to borrow the book? No. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam President.
Thank you for some of your statements, but I know that you did a great job with this, all the information you presented to us tonight. But there's still some things that are still not clear as far as, what would happen if someone was to, throw chickens in the yard and how would they...
We already have a law against open slaughter in Virginia.
And that's what we discussed earlier.
So there's already an existing law against open slaughter.
And also there's new laws right now about chaining an animal up over, 30 minutes an hour, a day or whatever. I think it can only be chained. This is right now about an hour a day, 1 hour per day, right? And I'm hearing
that
some animals are being chained. I've even had a call about a month ago about someone that chained a cat. So anyway, I know that there's things, we got to look at, some other things that we didn't want, to keep earlier tonight or today during the meeting. We discussed about a few things about it. If someone was to be caught killing the chickens out in their backyard, and would they be fined? And I know that you just brought up about $60 for permits, and then you say $10 for an animal, or for a dog, or whatever. I think that needs to
be. That's what we currently pay. And there was another amendment tonight about making harsher fines or penalties for people that break the laws for dogs.
Mm-hmm.
We are fully in favor of penalties for people that are breaking the laws, having roosters, having more than the allotted number, keeping them humanely. And we're thinking that penalties and fines for the calls that animal control has to go out regarding chickens makes more sense than a hefty $60 a year fee for flock owners, because we want to encourage people to come in and get permits. And I think with a $60 annual fee might be scaring away some people who would want to do the right thing and permit their flocks. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I appreciate, you coming here tonight and all the other nights that you've been here, pushing for this, but I just know that there's still a lot of questions that's unanswered, and then people that break the law with this, who's gonna enforce it? Is it gonna be animal control? Is it gonna be the police officers, which we know that the police do not want animal control under them, and right now I think it's under the suspension
limit? Well, I understand animal control is also in favor of this passing. The people that we've spoken with at animal control, and I don't want to put words in their mouths, but from what I understand, they are not against this at all. They are in favor of what we are proposing.
And thank you. We're going to have a lot of opportunity to discuss this because we've got a report today. I'm sure that someone just can be a pig around chicken paper. And I'm sure we're going to have lots of opportunity to talk about it and also for you guys to lobby everybody in council. So thanks.
And maybe I'll be happy to email you if you have any more questions.
The next speaker is Sheena Mayfield.
Good evening, Council. My name is Sheena Mayfield. I'm from the 3rd District, and I don't want to take up too much more of your time. I was also here to talk about chickens. I just wanted to give a big thank you to all the City Council, especially Councilmember Hilbert, Councilmember Samuels, Councilmember Jewell, and also the CAO office, Keith Richards. You guys being very patient with us, and it's always great to become involved in our community and being able to come here and speak to you and learn about your process and also find something you really believe in as an important democratic process. And I'm glad that it's open for all of us to do. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sure we'll see you lots more.
Madam President, those are all of tonight's speakers.
Thank you.
Madam President.
Yes, sir.
Just to that gaggle of chicken advocates. I gotta tell you, they've been good. They've been just like Buddhist monks coming down here patiently, educating us here, cajoling us there, giving us more information than we can ever consume. And excellent job of advocating. I just wish that others would take that lesson, that we hear the learning from you. And to the extent that you all can educate us on things that you think are right, worth fighting for, we encourage more people to do it. So I just thank them because they've been like Buddhist folks. They've been working on us.
Thank you, Joe. At this time, we're going to go to the regular agenda. Before we go there, the regular agenda deals mainly with tax exempt papers. The first paper has been. So the only papers on the regular agenda are those tax exempt papers. I need to read something in our discussion. There could be questions about some of the information that the tax exempt organization had to give. And so if it's asked for in this public hearing, then we're going to have to be able to see it. So before I open the public hearing on these papers, please be advised that each applicant for tax exemption submitted certain tax or business information in support of the application that might otherwise be protected by the confidentiality provisions of Section 58.1-3 of the Code of Virginia. The city takes a position that an applicant waives those protections by submitting its application to participate in the process that of necessity requires a public hearing. Any applicant that wishes to ensure that confidential information will not be discussed during this public hearing should immediately come forward and withdraw its application. So, having read that, so nobody rushing forward to withdraw their application. We'll move forward. We're going to take these papers in a block. And so this time, is there anyone here to speak in favor? Well, let's do opposition first, in opposition to any of these tax exempt papers.
Before you, since we're going to take all
these
papers in a block, I need to throw on record that I have a conflict with interest on ordinance number 2012-138 and ordinance number 2012-121, and I will not be voting on those two papers.
Thank you. Before we go to public comment, we need to confirm to read those papers into the record. Yes, sir.
If I mentioned here, I need to make a disclosure relative to some items on the regular agenda. Employer, the Virginia Housing Development Authority, financing for Boaz and Bridge in regards to some of these properties. Those are items number 30, 33, 34, 38, 39, and 40. And however, I have no direct interest or did not approve these loans, and making this disclosure
item number 30 is ordinance number 2012-115 to exempt 103 Giles Avenue from real property taxation for 2012 year upon the continued use of the property by Boaz Group Incorporated. Item number 30 is ordinance 116 to exempt 1207 Giles Avenue for real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Boaz and Group Incorporated. Item number 32, ordinance number 2012-117 to exempt 1211 Giles Avenue for real property taxation for 2012 upon continued use by the property. Use of the property by Boaz and Group Incorporated. Item number 33, ordinance number 2012-118 to exempt 1212 Highland Avenue, Highland View Avenue for real property taxation for 2012 upon continued use of the property by Boaz and Group Incorporated. Item number 34, ordinance number 2012-119 to exempt 1213 Giles Avenue for real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Boaz and Group Incorporated. Item number 35, ordinance number 2012-121 to exempt 201 North Hamilton Street from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Virginia Lee of Four Planned Parenthood, Inc. And Councilman Tyler has expressed he has a conflict of interest with that item. Will not be voting on it. Item number 36, ordinance number 2012-124 to exempt 2320 Broad Rock Boulevard from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by New Life for Youth Incorporated. Item 37, ordinance number 2012-127 to exempt 2915 Broad Rock Boulevard from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by New Life for Youth Incorporated. Item 38, ordinance number 2012-129 to exempt 3005 First Avenue from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Boaz and Group Incorporated. Item number 39, ordinance number 2012-130 to exempt 3007 First Avenue from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Boaz and Group Incorporated. Item number 40, ordinance number 2012-131 to exempt 3019 First Avenue from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Boaz and Ruth. Item 41, ordinance number 2012-134 to exempt 5748 Orchid Lane from real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by New Life for Youth Incorporated. Item number 42, ordinance number 2012-135 to exempt 5754 Orchid Lane for real property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by New Life for Youth Incorporated. And item number 43, ordinance number 2012-138 to exempt certain personal property from personal property taxation for 2012 upon the continued use of the property by Virginia Lee for Planned Parenthood Incorporated. And Councilman Tyler has also expressed a conflict of interest with that item. Will not be voting on it as well. Those are all of the items.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. At this time, we'll hold a public hearing. Is there anyone that wishes to speak in opposition to any of these papers?
My name is Chris Dorsey. I'm going to speak in opposition to all the papers. And you know, first I'd like to begin by saying that there's really no authority that the city has to legitimately lay these taxes, and they don't benefit the average citizen of the city of Richmond. These taxes are used to benefit the people who run, I guess, Boaz and Ruth and many other places who just kind of, take taxpayer money and don't pay anything. That doesn't seem like it's any sort of fair bargain. And I hear and see the properties on at least a weekly basis, and you know, sometimes I go out to certain parts of town where this entity operates, and I see a neighborhood that is not improved by these nonprofit institutions that don't pay any taxes on the property that they have access to. I would just like to say, how is it that we're pushing through all of these properties and we keep hearing the same names over and over again, you know, nonprofits, churches, you know, abortion clinics. I don't think we all agree that these places shouldn't pay taxes. You know, I mean, we have our current mayor, the one that's mayor right now. He uses his church as a nonprofit status, and then he uses his influence as mayor to get a gigantic contract for the construction company, TK Davis, who's representing him to get tax-free status in Chesterfield County. So I just think that this is just another part of the giant scams that y'all carried out, and the whole thing is just a sham, and it's all fake money anyways. But, you know, pretty much everything you do is in violation of this document, and, you know, I think pretty soon that proverbial ish is going to hit the fan for y'all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. I'm Teddy Carroll, and I am speaking in opposition of Boaz and Ruth getting their nonprofit status. I have lived in Howland Park almost 30 years, and it was a nice little community. The people weren't wealthy, but they had pride and dignity and honor. Boys and Ruth has come in and raped the community, along with the help of Ellen Robinson. A lot of the homeless people that I work with now on the daily basis own homes in Howland Park. Boys and Ruth has come there, and they've gotten a fire station that RCAP and I and others were fighting for the citizens, for the city of Richmond, to go to take care of their personal business now. The people stand out in the rain across from Ellen Robinson's house, and I guess she watches them while they get bread or leftover food or whatever substances they can carry. It's a shame and a disgrace. In Highland Park, we have about 5 thrift stores, Boaz and Ruth. They even took one of my friend's businesses that he had been in over 40 years, the dirty building code inspector, to Art's and Alice's place of business after 40 years, when the grandfather clause could have saved them. It killed that woman. We cannot continue to let these individuals that hide behind a tax-free status continually come in here and rape our city. All of these organizations are not for the good of the people. And some of you all know it. I don't know how you sleep at night. I don't know how you get along through the day, knowing that you have hurt so many, knowing that you have destroyed so many when you were put here to help. How can you go against the citizens of the city? A chicken will get more attention than the human beings. You know, it's bad, and the world is watching. The world is truly watching, and if you believe in a higher power, he or she is too. And I say no to Boaz and Ruth getting that permit. Let the investigation go forth, and that will bring about H.P. Rapp and Ellen Robinson also. So they have a debt to pay to the society. If you give them a nonprofit status, and then I wonder, how can they pull their horse trailer with those fine thoroughbreds in it? You know, I'm like, the trailer must have cost me $100,000, and the horses cost more than that. These people are not poor. These people have come in and figured out a way, like so many other tax-free organizations, how to get over on the poor, how to give less.
Yes, 30 seconds.
You didn't say 30 seconds for anybody else that stood up here and spoke 20 minutes. What's your problem?
You have 30 seconds to answer.
Well, all you crooks are going down. It's just a matter of time. And I sure hope investigators, it will be before the election. Everyone that I tell you about that I know for a fact, and here's my hand,
your hand is up.
You vote, you give them awards, and pat them on the back. Oh, well, what a fool.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Silver Percy. I'm a citizen of Richmond, Virginia. I don't know much about Boaz and Ruth. I went by this thrift store twice. I ate at the restaurant once. But there are 14 papers on the regular agenda. 8 of them are pertaining to properties owned by Boaz and Ruth. 4 of them are for New Life, for youth, whatever that organization is. So that's 12 papers out of 14 to 2 organizations. As Mr. Hilbert said in his earlier comments, the papers on the regular agenda were not approved by, I guess, the committee that was put together to review tax exempt. Is that correct? The statuses? And Boaz and Ruth has already received 1 exemption on 3030 Meadow Bridge. That was on the consent agenda. So to me, it seemed like, you know, they talk about picking winners and losers, and you're making a conscious decision here. And there are hundreds, well, I don't know if there's hundreds, but there are many nonprofits here in town. And here you have 2 organizations eating up, you know, 90% of the agenda. I'm just going to oppose it on those grounds that, to me, it seems like these 2 organizations, I don't know if they're getting preferential treatment. They probably just knew city council members who told them to apply for this exemption. And, you know, you're free to apply, but the city doesn't have to grant these exemptions. And me, as well as the 2 previous citizens, were saying don't do it. Thank you for the opportunity to comment.
Thank you, Senator. Is there anybody here who is in favor of any of these papers?
Good evening. Honorable City Council President, the Vice President, honorable members of City Council. I want to talk just briefly that tax exempt, a thing that for personal private property use in the city at this time. When everybody's going to economic this thing, I think it's in the right direction. I would have to know who are the owners of the property. And then, in fact, I left a message for Honorable City Council Vice President, Ellen Robertson, about Convention Center. And I made a passionate appeal that all fever blow in city of Richmond should be earmarked, and the people must know filler buildings and the building that they continue building today. When me, Benjamin Tonama, could have made a case to the former president John W. Bush and revisited it, and President Barack Obama adopted the policy they are building their house. Why don't you inform the people who are the owners of those buildings? The people have the right to know. So I want to use this occasion that is said. European Union foreign ministers took a decision at their meeting. They sent it to me here in the city of Asia. I was sitting in Iran. But the city is blind. Don't know who is Benonito Nankudi in your city. Wanted to destroy me. You don't like diversity? I'm taking this opportunity to inform you that this is my last week in the city of Richmond. Wherever I will be, I will tell my stories. All my properties and my money stolen in this city that I cannot receive even my own letters up to today. I want you, the city authority, to take a very serious decision about this. Because if I leave, I will use every diplomatic means to get everything stolen from me in this city. May God bless you. Anybody that comes to your city, please open your heart and your doors and your arms and your hand and receive them. May God bless you. And may this city one day.
We have that, right? We...
They're all nonprofit.
He wants to move those, but it's not...
They're all...
They're all...
I mean, Bowes and Root?
Oh, that's...
That kind of corporation owns them all, that nonprofit. Okay, now is anyone else to speak in favor?
So I'm Paulette Popcorn, and I'm the president and CEO of the Digital League for Planned Parenthood. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we do, and then hopefully you'll ask some questions, because apparently there were some. So VLPP is an independent 501c3 nonprofit. I believe we met all the same requirements of the Friends Association. I was there at the hearing. We serve the Metro Richmond area. 88% of our patients live in the city. We provide some more complex gynecological services to treat women who have pre-cancer cervical conditions to the other safety net providers in the surrounding counties. So we take all those referrals, which is why we have some patients come outside of the city. We see 12,000 patients a year in our health center. We provide primary care, family planning, and low-cost contraceptives in our health center. 85% of our services are preventative. We're open 6 days a week, including evenings and weekends. This tax abatement would allow us to see an additional 500 women a year. So just to give you a comparison of what we do compared to the health department, who we are a partner of, we actually have a full-time staff member that's helping them with our prenatal program at the health department here in the city. We've invested tens and tens of thousands of dollars in improving their prenatal program at the health department. It's unfortunate that Dr. Stern didn't mention us in his list of partners. They provide 12 hours a week of family planning services, and we provide 64. So the number of women we see for the services that the city provides is exponential. We also take their referrals for women. So when women come in for a pap smear and they get a negative result, the city can't provide the services they need. They send them to us and we take care of them. We do that for all the county health departments, we do it for the city health department, we do it for all the universities and colleges that have that provide services at the university. And another statistic, for every dollar spent on family planning services, you save $4 in public funding. So this is an investment, this is not an expense. And I'm happy to take questions about Planned Parenthood and what we do. I mean, we are probably one of the most misunderstood organizations.
Madam President.
Yes, sir, Mr. Paul.
No. I'm supposed to ask questions, but I do want to make a point there. Your last statement says it all. You've been caught in a political maelstrom. Public have no idea what Planned Parenthood does other than that one element called abortion. But the services are enormous. The city and the region is better for it. So I just appreciate your educating that system. What Planned Parenthood really is, because it's tough to get past those big microphones during this high holy election season. Thank you for that.
Thank you. And just one note, our services have probably seen four times as many patients as we did 5 years ago with this economy, and we have managed to get them all in our doors and see them. And you can get in our office in 24 hours if you have a need and you can't get into another doctor. So we are here helping people who are losing their insurance right and left.
Thank you. Anyone else to speak?
I start to turn to the fourth page, it's got a map. By the way, there have been so many mentions of the number of papers, and I want you to understand our vision.
First, sorry, you can't.
Oh, excuse me, sorry.
I know everybody knows who you are, but for the record, you need to tell them.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. All right. I'm Arthur Rawlings, CEO of Boaz and Ruth, which is located in Northside. Our vision is a healthy community of people living in relation with one another. When I told Ellen it was too dangerous to be in Highland Park, and she just smiled and invited us anyway, and we came to realize that presence can create safety. So we began to, 80% of the girls were boarded up, and as we've had the means to fill an abandoned building or a building that had perhaps not everything legal going on in it, we acquired them and restored them in a very small footprint. You can see the blue buildings are the housing that these papers are being voted about. The red buildings are the stores, or the, we call them life labs, because it's where people learn and they're trained in working hard and also creating a presence for the community. If you look at the graph on the other page, it measures the, we didn't set out to do this, it's sort of a good thing for us, but it's, fullness is better than emptiness. And so as we, as the buildings that empty and if the means came available, we filled it with something good. And you can see how crime has dropped 61% during this period. These were based on figures from the police department, and they dropped 30% in the other nearby precincts. But we think the extra difference is having a commercial car that has activity. I experienced that as a merchant in Cary County. 30 years, I saw crime drop as we drove the emptiness with good things. So that's a piece of our vision. The buildings that you're looking at in these papers are related to our housing. We provide housing for men and women. It's low-income housing. It's not group homes. It would be more like a shared apartment. Each one has the appropriate number of people or less living in it to meet all the codes. We should not be confused as group homes, because we're people living in community with one another. The one thing that's different about us from, say, another place one is that our buildings are totally furnished. Light bulbs, kitchen equipment, so forth. All the heat, utilities are paid. We have free internet within a several block area radius. And so all that's included in a person's rent. You'll get an attached financial summary in a minute, but you'll see from that we are compassionate in the way we...
Your time is up. Thank you.
Yeah, my 3 minutes. Okay, we got compassion in the way we deal with people. Thank you. I'm going to introduce Steve Robinson, who's one of our tenants. Is this
Steve right? You need 3 minutes too.
Affordable housing. Boys and Ruth takes in almost
Thank you.
Madam President, members of council, I'm Jim Ryan. I'm a lawyer in Richmond, helping the OAS group on a pro bono basis, and have done that for some time, and I'm proud of the association of our firm with such a great organization. I want to just make a couple of points. First of all, I'd like to pass out, this is a, you know, on the rental housing. Look at, it gives you a thumbnail sketch of the situation in these houses on a rental basis. You look down through that, this is for calendar year 2011, which has been audited, and these are the numbers from the audited financials. Gross rental income of not quite $150,000. A lot of rental expenses that total up to $109,000. One credit in there is the city police pays us for the use, utilities on the use of part of one of these buildings. So that's that $5,300 is money that comes in from the city for the use rent-free of part of one of our apartment buildings. At the bottom, you can see, after taking out depreciation, uncollectible rents and taxes, OAS and Roof loses $62,000 plus on its operations. A large chunk of that is uncollectible rents, and part of that has already been touched on. The people that rent these apartments don't put down a deposit because they can't afford a deposit, and that doesn't give much of a cushion to OAS and Roof. And they try to work with people when they get behind in the rents, if they get sick, and they have other problems. And they sometimes have people that are recalcitrant and getting out, and it's just impossible to collect all the rents. Taxes are a big chunk, $18,000 a year on these houses, and that is what OAS and Roof would like to be exempt from. I'd like to touch also on the issue of group whether these are group homes. I looked fairly diligently for a definition of group homes in the Virginia Code, City Code, and couldn't find one, but they're in the Citizen's Guide to Residential and Institutional Uses in the City of Richmond, which is a pamphlet which you have online. There are four criteria. They are concerning group homes. The first is occupancy is not generally available or available to the general public. Most, but not all, of the residents in these houses are OAS and Roof trainees, people that are in the program, and some are not. People that...
you have 30 seconds. Please begin to summarize.
Yes, people that are not in the program are still, if they want to, rent there in their space, can rent there. The second and third criteria I won't touch on, but fourth is supervision is provided. This is not a group home. There is no supervision. Are in our programs, our training programs, and they benefit from those, but they're not supervised in these houses. So these are not group homes.
Your time is up.
Under your definition. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for your hard work with this group.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else here to speak for any of these papers? I'm going to bring back to Councilman Robertson.
Thank you, Madam President. I would like to speak to the papers that are on the regular agenda, the tax exemption. And I would like to preface my statement before I address the tax ones that are here, is that the committee that is appointed to look at the tax exempt applications that came in, all of the ones that we have considered already, the consent agenda and these that are before us at the present time, the committee recommendation by a vote of 5-0, which is the entire committee, only voted to support approval of two of the applications that came in. Council has given great consideration to all of the applicants, and we have learned tonight from the Planned Parenthood organization and the description of the services that is being provided, I don't know how we could, in great consciousness, not recognize the value of the services that is being provided by this organization. Secondly, the services being provided by Boys and Roof, let me just say, I live within 2 blocks of every one of these houses. I know what they looked like before they were renovated by Boys and Roof. I know the families that live in those units. I go to the restaurant 4 or 5 times a day. I mean, a week. I go there so often that when I walk in, they pretty much know it, that front conference room is open. That's where I want to eat and that's where I want to have my meal. And I take as many people as I can to Boys and Roof for regular meetings to share with them what is being done and what the services that is being provided by this organization. You know, like Planned Parenthood. It goes far beyond the scope of what we could elaborate upon tonight. People are exposed to all kinds of folk from all over. I mean, Martha Rollins has been to Washington, D.C. and actually talked to the president to support this initiative and has gotten his ear. They have tried a host of different types of initiatives to try to make it work. I know the struggle that this organization has gone through. I know the fact that Martha Rollins has served as the executive director, as she said, with a lot of influence, to come into this community and make a change. And she receives not one penny as a salary to do this work, because this organization cannot afford to pay her. And I know what that's like. I worked for an organization for years as well and wasn't paid a penny. I'm working for a nonprofit organization right now in the city that was barely paying us a penny. Madam President, I'm not going to belabor this. I support these organizations. I'm going to support the papers that are on the regular agenda, with the exception of 3 papers, paper number 41, 42, and 43. And the reason why I'm not going to support paper number 41 and paper number 43 is because they provide residence for the workers that run this program. And the other paper is the personal property paper for Planned Parenthood. And I think we are opening a level of tax exemption that this was not for the purpose of addressing, but for addressing the real property. And I would ask my colleagues to support the balance of the papers that are on the regular agenda. And also, as I stated earlier, I do intend to go page for paper with the moratorium, because I believe that there's a lot of work this council needs to do to get that together as it relates to the process, the review of this process. We should not be having applications that come in that the process is broken to the extent that only 2 get recommendation and we overrule the majority of non-qualified application. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Congressman. Jewel, that's
papers.
That she does not support.
Oh, she doesn't. Okay. Okay.
Paper number 41, which deals with the residency for all the ministers that administers the New Life Youth Incorporated. Okay. 42, which is the same, which provides for the residents of the ministers of the program. And number 43, which is for the personal property for Virginia Lake Planned Parenthood.
Okay. Mr. Jewell, you had a few comments?
Thank you, Madam President. I want to thank the way before she got on council. And to see these properties turn around and be occupied by people who live in them, who are partly responsible for keeping them up. They're doing their own maintenance. Someone went forward to do just that. She's got the restaurant over there, the old firehouse that was dilapidated, sitting there, rotting. They fixed that up, and they made an excellent restaurant out of it. Food's good, you ought to go. I talked earlier about how there are all of our nonprofits ain't poor. Well, you got Virginia Museum that's been designated by General Assembly as tax exempt. They ain't poor. You've got Science Museum. That by the National Service, they ain't poor. You've got all sorts of not-for-profits throughout this city designated by the General Assembly, by the big shots, for the big shots. But these are small entities that are struggling like the devil every day. And the least we can do, given the ancillary services that they provide, not only the direct service, but the ancillary services they provide, the benefits that they bring to these neighborhoods, I don't know that we need to worry about a moratorium, Ms. Robinson, because there aren't that many not-for-profits already exempt that ain't big shots that own their own facilities. Amen. So all this talk about opening floodgates, I think, is a bit of folly. Yeah, there are plenty of nonprofits, but very few of them own their own properties, and we're looking at the metal right about here. I would be remiss if I didn't address one of the speakers tonight who accused Boaz and Ruth and these folks of being criminals. I think it is a cheap shot. And I think it was totally uncalled for. Marvin Rollins is one of the shining lights in this city. Has been, always will be. Her husband, Randy Rollins, is the former Secretary of Public Safety in Virginia. The top cop in Virginia. He runs a nonprofit called Ride to Work. He's driving people to work. Retired driving people to work ain't being a dime. What is wrong with us? So I think I needed to make that point that this stuff is pretty noxious stuff that came in front of us, and to let it go unaddressed, I think, would be a disservice. So, I thank y'all for your support. I think you've been sufficiently educated, and I hope you will all vote for all of these papers. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.
You know, this is not exactly what we voted to do, you see, you know. And it's kind of tough, these folks from down here, and plead their case. When we didn't get enough information to begin with. You know, I feel very uncomfortable about that. Having said that, okay, Mr. Robinson has decided, well, Boaz and Ruth, I think, is a very good organization. I have no reason to doubt that. But we're splitting these up. Now, if we're going to take 41, 42, 43 off, and that's what Mr. Robinson said, yeah, I would be willing to take off 36 and 37. That's new life as well, or two more from new life. And I can go along with balance of this, but this is not exactly what I started to do, but I'm willing to do that. So I will vote to support everything except for 36, 37, 41, 43, and 43. A little complicated.
And other comments?
No question.
Yes, sir.
That's new life as well, and I don't have information on it. I really don't know enough about it to do it. So that's my personal opinion. We didn't get enough information to begin with, so we kind of split this thing up a little bit, you know. But that's my rationale for this. I'm not here tonight to tell you what they did. It really puts us at a disadvantage because they're not here. I would much rather done this a different way. See? So that's my rationale for what I'm doing.
Would you ask to continue those papers then, since they're not here to...
Well, I'll be willing to continue, sure. But that was my first vote to begin with, continue the papers that we couldn't get a consensus on. Yeah. That was the first thing I asked to do, but that didn't really want to go along with that. I'm still willing to do that, but it's up to the body members what they want to do.
But Mr. Conner, just to get it straight, at this point, you are willing to support all the papers with the exception of 36, which is New Life, 37, which is New Life, 41, which is New Life, 42, which is New Life, and 43, which is personal property tax for Planned Parenthood.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
Just kind of good. Ms. Newbell?
Thank you, Madam President. I guess I need to wait on papers 36 and 37 until Mr. Conner is making a decision, because you're looking to have information come back.
What Mr. Conner said was that they were not supported by the committee. They were not supported by... We did not have any information, and this is a public hearing. The people who represent these organizations know this was a public hearing. They're not even here tonight to speak. So,
we don't have enough information to make a good judgment on it.
Madam President,
can you
come back?
Yes, ma'am.
Let's let me look at these again.
Can I come back?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Gilbert, you have a few words of wisdom?
Well, I'll try.
Okay.
Thank you, Madam President. What we've gone through here just in the last 10 minutes here, I can't support any of these on the regular agenda. I said I was going to support them earlier, and I think the process has been difficult, and I'm just not comfortable with that. I think I've said that on numerous occasions, and I'm not going to change my mind now. And so I won't be supporting any of these papers on the regular agenda. I think these organizations do wonderful work, but I think we owe it to have a defined process, and I hope that I'll have some support, Ms. Robinson and myself, on putting this moratorium back in place. We get some of these organizations money in other sources, and I'd be happy to continue to do that and increase it where we can. I just believe that giving a tax exemption is the wrong thing to do. Relative to Mr. Tyler's comments, I believe earlier, was that $214 million, I think, of all the nonprofit organizations? Is that correct?
No, it was $241
million. I'm sorry, $241 million. If we gave every one of them an exemption, that'd be, I don't know, $2.7 million or somewhere in that neighborhood. So, you know, if we're going to treat everybody equitably, I think that's a logical argument just to exempt. But this picking and choosing is just difficult to do, as has been displayed this evening. So I'll be voting out on all of these. Despite the great work of these organizations.
Ms. Gill?
Yes, thank you, Madam President. I will be voting in favor of all of the papers on the regular agenda, with the exception of the items 41, 42, 43, the first, and 43, because we were addressing real property as opposed to
When we go, my number, you support everything with the exception of 36, 37, 41, 42, 43, is that correct?
That would be correct.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Mr. Tower, on your side, any comments? Well, go for it.
Madam President, thank you. First of all, once again, I think it's important to understand what these organizations are doing for our city. And I appreciate the person that come down and speak with regards to statistical information. I think that really does frame it. I would say that to Mr. Hilbert, I would hope that we would look at this tax exemption thing bigger light than just what we've been through tonight. The total that we are exempting folks is roughly about $2.9 million of real estate tax to the city of Richmond, which is, depending on which way you look at the budget, not a large sum of money if you use the million plus that we actually use for the 600 cell that we actually put on for the general fund. And I think in the long run, we will find ourselves and put more money towards social services if these organizations aren't sure enough. So thank you.
Thank you. Can I have any comments? Mr. Samuels?
Yes. You get what you pay for.
Yes, sir.
And a lot of nonprofits in the city do incredible work. And you're good. That's not the criteria we have to decide these cases by. There's both state law and the ordinance that gives detailed instruction to mandate us to make a decision based on those criteria. It's not that we should just blindly rubber stamp every application or if we deny every application. It would be easier, and I agree that it would make life a lot more simple, but it would be abdicating our duty if we can't do that. The state sets the rules, we have to follow them. It's hard work, it's potentially unpopular work. We weren't elected here to just make people in the nonprofit world happy. We were elected to make decisions easy and hard for the benefit, the greater good of the entire city. There's a criterion, there's a process in place. It's only when new information comes to light that we should change the recommendations of the committee. They put hours of work into these. They went through questionnaires. They went through tax statements. They went through tax rolls as well to make sure there weren't any problems there. If the criteria isn't met, we should not support a nonprofit just because we like the work they did. That being said, if the criteria is met, we should wholeheartedly embrace it. It cannot be an all or nothing situation. It has to be each organization stands on their own merits. I said earlier, you get what you pay for, and at this point I want to thank the attorney for Boaz and Ruth for his pro bono service. This is the exception that proves the rule. Thanks to your definition of a group home, I was able to feel much better about the Boaz and Ruth papers. And Boaz and Ruth, folks, you're very fortunate to have that gentleman with you. But I can't get around the fact that there were problems with some of the others because they just don't meet the state of local criteria. And I'm really sad and sorry about that because I personally would like to vote in favor of each and every one of them, but I can't. Ms. Roberts and Mr. Elder both said some of the reasons already, and I'll leave it at that. But I don't want us to get lost in, we should give everybody this or nobody this. There's a process in place. We've got a work plan, and our old friend Ralph Harris used to say, plan the work and then work the plan. We've got a way to do this. I don't think we need to necessarily revoke or put back in place the moratorium. We just have to realize that these meetings are going to get a lot longer as we go through these one at a time. And unfortunately, that's the position that we have put ourselves in, except Mr. Hill. We put him in that position. But I really do believe that if we're going to do this, we can't take it all on the approach. We
state lays out, criteria that they lay out, includes one that says, and I'm paraphrasing, and whatever the local, the municipality sees fit to set. Now, that's paraphrasing. And so there were no rigid criteria laid down for us, but and I have to agree with Mr. Sammons that our criteria just was poorly prescribed. It was poorly done. When you don't have criteria that says that speaks to hardship, then you're missing the main point. And none of that criteria that we gave that committee address hardship, financial hardship. All of these papers, all of the grantees, have a sunset every 3 years. I don't think anybody's mentioned that. And the city assessor has the authority to sunset them if they miss any of their primary criteria. So we're not stuck with this ad infinitum. The last point, though, is that since it appears, that we don't have the votes for all of them, I would recommend that 37, 38, 41, 42, and 43 be continued until which time additional information is brought forward. This whole notion of lifting the moratorium, I think even that requires more information that the city assessor can provide for us that will show you that there aren't a lot more organizations out there that own their own property that would be coming here asking for these exemptions. I move that we continue items 36, 37, 41, 42,
Thank you, Mr. Jules. Second to Mr. Jules' motion. I think Mr. O'Connor seconded that motion. Okay. Did you get the motion, or do you need to hear it again?
If you can repeat that, please.
Okay.
I move that the papers 36, 37, 41, 42, and 43 be continued until 30 days.
Okay. And we have a second from Mr. Connor. Any discussion? All right. Let's call the question.
Council is voting on Councilman Jules.
Thank you.
Mr. Samuels?
No.
Mr. Gilbert?
No.
Vice President Robinson?
No.
Mr. Jewell?
Aye.
Ms. Nuda?
No.
Ms. Trammell?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye, with the exception of number 43, which I cannot vote on.
President Graziano?
No.
The motion is failed?
No, wait a minute. I'm sorry. That's it, well, I meant yes. I'm voting to not, no, I'm voting not to continue. No, that's okay. No,
so
no.
You're good.
All right.
That motion has failed.
Oh, okay. Thanks. All right. Okay. So we're, everybody has had their stands. All right.
Call a question. Call a question. Call a question on those five.
I believe that it is. Really, the question is not whether or not these groups provide services for the community. They often provide great services for the community. Some of them provide such great services for the community that not only do we want to tax exempt them, we fund them as well. Some of these do such a great work for the city that we have huge contracts with them, in which we pay them large amounts of money to do the job that they do, and they also want to have a tax exempt. The papers in the regular agenda did not, for the main part, that's how they came here in the regular agenda, did not meet the criteria of either the hearing of the committee or when we discussed them in council. We said we needed more information tonight on some of these groups. We refused. We received information. We have many groups that provide services. We need to remember we are also using taxpayer dollars to grant this relief. We must also take into account, although we're not discussing large amounts of money for this year, although this year, once we pass these tax exempt, we'll be losing about $700,000 a year for tax exempt. We passed the budget, which included these dollars in our revenue projections. And so now we've got to find a place to take these out of our budget and fund them. We put $584,000 in an amendment in our budget to cover tax-exempt properties. This adds another $100,000 for that.
It's $195,000 aggregate.
And I'm talking.
Oh.
Thank you.
Well, tell us.
Thank you. We have in our budget the budget amendment, which I can show
that
Dr. Newbell put in for $584,000 for existing tax exempt properties. That was in our budget.
Where are you getting $700,000?
We're adding another $100,000 to, excuse me, I will back up and say, 600 and about 75 or $76,000. I'm just trying to round it off. I have heard tonight that the city has deep pockets, that revenue is not a problem, that all of those nonprofits who provide service should be tax exempt. It is penny wise and pound foolish to tax nonprofits. Here, I agree with Silver Persinger. Silver Persinger says we have hundreds and hundreds of nonprofits, which we do. Should we just fund them all? Should we just tax exempt every single nonprofit in the city? We need to consider what our criteria is. It is not well defined. We did not have good information. Almost every single group that came to us, we approved. We need to find a better system. I agree with Mr. Samuels in that there are occasions where there are nonprofits that we should give some tax exempt to, but we should have very strict, stringent regulations, not subjective idea, subjective criteria, or anybody can fit into it. That's all I'm going to say at this time, and Mr. Van Kirk. what if he would call a roll, and what I would like is if each person would give the number of the tax exempt paper that they approve of. Yes, sir, Mr. Gilmore.
There was discussion here that this is on a 3-year rolling basis.
Correct. Every 3 years you have to reapply. Or you don't have to reapply. The assessor looks at it every 3 years.
The assessor just has to say, right, well, let me make that clear. These properties are tax exempt in perpetuity as long as they're used for the use at which they're rendered tax exempt. So if these organizations, even if they sell them to another organization and they're used for the same purpose, these properties, is that selling the property? Is that, but it's the use, isn't it? It's both. So as long as these properties are used for the purpose and it's not another organization, they can't even transfer these to another nonprofit. Okay. This is on a 3-year basis, but if there's no change in the use of these properties, and they're certified by the assessor, these properties are exempt in perpetuity.
Correct.
And I just want everybody to know that. And every one of these properties that we add to this roll, in theory, could be off the tax roll forever. Thank you.
Right now, would you please... Yes, sir.
I'm trying to understand.
If you have, just like we do for tax relief for the elderly, you have to put a line item in the budget that shows where you have the money to replace the revenue that is going away. We had many, many tax-exempt properties. We had to have a place in the budget where that's expressed because they're covered on the assessor's, they're covered in the assessor's books. You've got to reflect someplace where that budget, where that revenue is not coming in.
All right.
Of agenda item number, agenda items number 41, 42, and 43.
May I make a friendly amendment to that?
Yes.
May I add number 36 and number 37?
Yes.
Okay. So we will be voting on the, all of the papers on the regular agenda with the exception of 36, 37, 41, 22, 43. Everybody got that?
Yes.
Okay.
I remove my second.
What are you doing with your second?
I remove my second.
Call a question on the clerk.
Council is voting on Vice President Robertson's motion to approve all regular agenda items with the exception of 41, 42, 43, 36, and 37. Mr. Conner?
Aye.
Mr. Samuels?
Aye.
Mr. Gilbert?
No.
Vice President Robertson?
Aye.
Mr. Jewell?
No.
Ms. Newville?
I would first like to thank Ms. Palmer and Swain for coming on to provide clarifying information regarding the legal main character. Services for women throughout the primarily city of Richmond. Just want to say thank you and aye.
Ms. Randall?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye, with the exception of 43.
President Graziano?
The two Planned Parenthoods, or don't you have to abstain on both of those? It's from
one of those.
So it's one of those.
Okay. I just want to make sure you
remember. Yeah, no, and I appreciate you.
Okay.
Yeah, the other one will abstain later.
That motion has passed.
All right, now we have an expedited resolution.
Yes, we have one resolution for expedited consideration. That is resolution number 2012-R17 to direct the council chief of staff to have prepared and to have affixed an appropriate plaque honoring Ruby Giles Turner for the chair of the council chambers in City Hall where Ms. Turner customarily sat when she attended city council meetings. I will need a motion for expedited consideration of that. Council is voting on expedited consideration of that paper. Mr. Conner?
Aye.
Mr. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Gilbert?
Aye.
Vice President Robertson?
Aye.
Mr. Jewell?
Aye.
Ms. Newville?
Aye.
Ms. Trammell?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye.
President Graziano?
Aye.
That paper is before you.
All right, is there anyone in the audience to speak in favor or in opposition? Back to council for discussion.
Madam President, someone is approaching.
Oh, excuse me, sorry, I didn't see it coming.
Sorry.
Well, but I didn't agree with you, you didn't like that.
What?
You did agree with me.
Yeah. But you went back and you approved that application with the wrong street address. However, I would like to speak in support of this plaque for Ruby Turner. I am a little disappointed. I saw it being held up. It appeared kind of cheap. If you guys want to make a better plaque, let me know, and I'd be happy to contribute $10 or $20. This sets good precedent. Maybe I will get my own plaque one day, or maybe a Chris Dorsey or Donald Hatcher or Teddy Carroll. Thank you for this plaque for Ruby Turner.
All right, any other person to speak? Back to council. Consideration. All the questions are
Council is voting on resolution number 2012-R117. Mr. Connor?
Aye.
Mr. Samuels?
Aye.
Mr. Hilbert?
Aye.
Vice President Robertson?
Aye.
Mr. Jewell?
Aye.
Ms. Newville?
Aye.
Ms. Grant?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye.
President Graziano?
Aye.
Thank you, Madam President. Approval of the minutes.
Madam President.
Is that?
Relative to the items on the agenda for which we did not vote and the resolution failed to continue them, these items are hanging out there by my account. So we either need to vote them up or down since they measure.
Joe, if we don't vote for them, that's not a disapproval. You're saying it doesn't.
Well, we have them on the agenda. We rebuffed.
All right, let's take.
Move to continue them. I don't know that we can pick up them.
We did not.
To continue them since we just voted that down.
We did not continue them, so that's not appropriate. Let's go back to that agenda. Take those papers that we pulled out. And we need to take action on them. Thank you, Mr. Hilbert. You should have been a lawyer.
I was simply, you're right, I can't take credit for that.
Oh, was a lawyer?
Said that.
I'll see that tomorrow.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hilbert. Okay. Aye, can we please have a vote on those papers?
Yes, council is voting on the regular agenda items number 36, 37, 41, 42, and 43. Mr. Connor?
Yes.
We're voting.
Yes.
No.
We took those out.
Voted.
We voted to approve the other ones. And now we're voting to either approve these also or to vote no. Correct, Mr. Council?
No.
We're voting what now?
We pulled paper number 36, 37, 41, 42, 43 out.
Pull them out of the running.
Out of the running. We approve the other papers. Now we have to vote whether we approve these or do not approve these. Everybody got it?
Mr. Samuels?
No.
Mr. Gilbert?
No.
Vice President Robertson?
No.
Mr. Jewell?
Aye.
Ms. Newville?
No.
Ms. Trammell?
No.
Mr. Tyler?
No. And this is what I should say for number 43.
Okay.
And correct back on the other one to go back to, was it item number? Trying to make it 40. Yeah.
35 and 43.
Yes, thank you.
And President Graziano?
No.
Those papers have not been adopted.
Thank you very much, Councilor Samuels. Thank you. Okay, now we have approval of minutes.
Mr. Trammell?
Aye.
Mr. Tyler?
Aye.
Madam President Graziano? The minutes have been approved.
Okay. Thank you, Madam President. This time, we can have some reports from the council people. Start, Mr. Connor.
Thank you, Madam President. The only thing I had to report is our cleanup coming this Saturday. 5515 Bryce Lane, 8 o'clock, we'll do our regular monthly cleanup. We also have our district meeting coming up on the 25th, which is on Tuesday at 5 o'clock. At the same address, 5515 Bryce Lane. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. Sam?
Thank you. The second district will be hosting their quarterly town hall meeting on September 13th, 5:30. That's going to be at the roundhouse at Burton Park. We're going to have special guest Bob Seidel, who's the director of the public utilities for the city, and Rosemary Green, who is the deputy director there, to bring all your public utility questions. Also, I'm very excited to report that the contract was completed today to bring Clean and Safe, the program you see downtown, into the Lower Fan and to the Carver neighborhood at no cost to the taxpayer. And that was a lot of work by both this council. I want to thank my colleagues for helping me with that. We put a lot of hours into it. I also want to thank Lynn Lancaster and the finance department for the hard work they did to make that happen. And keep your eye out for them. If everything works according to plan, you should start seeing them in just a little bit over a month starting to come out onto the streets. Lastly, or additionally, the Broad Street stoplight question that you have maybe read about in one of the local periodicals or perhaps have seen these recommended changes there. We're going to have a community meeting on September 26th at 5:30, and that's going to be at Triangle Theater, 1300 Altamont Avenue in Scott's Addition. And lastly, in conjunction with Richmond, Virginia, the Richmond Regional Planning District Commission and the National Association of Regional Councils will be holding a solar workshop on September 17th at Artworks. There's more information if you're interested at www.narc.org/solarops. And don't forget, people each year talk about they were surprised by the traffic due to the marathon. October 6th will be the warm-up for the Great 2015 race. It's called the Grand Fondo. There's going to be three races that are going through the city and the surrounding counties. So please plan your driving or traveling by alternate means accordingly, as there will be significant traffic backups on certain routes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Samuels. Ms. Taylor?
Thank you, Madam President. Thank you, Madam President. The Health, Human Services, and Education Committee, is now the Education and Human Services Committee, met in August, and we heard a presentation on the addressing the computer needs of our young people through Richmond Public Schools. We did hear a presentation from Dr. Carey on a dollar amount needed for that, and we'll continue to explore other options on that to give access to our computer access to the young people that reside in the city of Richmond. This is critical for moving us forward. Make sure that computer access is there. So we
Thank you, Mr. Hilger. Mr. Tyler?
Thank you, Madam President. On September 25th, Tuesday at 6:30, there will be a town hall meeting for the 1st District at Mary Munford. Two items are going to be on the agenda. One, we're going to have a report from Lieutenant Stoke with regards to the issues that we've been facing in the 1st District. Unfortunately, we had some shed break-ins, and they have continued in some of the burglaries. Several folks have been apprehended. However, we still seem to be having these issues as we move forward. Even as I speak today, earlier today, we had some additional break-ins to shed. So I'm hoping that Lieutenant Stoke can share information and share what the police are doing. Also, we're going to have Dominion show up and talk about how they are servicing us with regards to being proactive about keeping lines active prior to storms and after storms, and also how they in fact go about restoring power. Unfortunately, we've had a few incidents here recently where we lost power for a number of days, and so I'm looking forward to the folks at Dominion to come and discuss what they're doing on our behalf. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.
Thank you, Madam President. First, they were at 9-8 district meeting last month. They did a great job. Let us know because, you know, they had a lot of folks and all that. They did an excellent job in the county. On Thursday, September the 20th, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., this is going to be our next 8 district meeting at the satellite 4000 block of Jefferson Davis. Our deputy CAO, Mr. Peter Chapman from Economic Development, will be there to talk to us about some great things that's not only happening in the district, but all of the state. Also, Anthony Lane, who is the director of the MS, will be there at our meeting to discuss different things with us about how to prepare for a tornado hurricane, what you do before and after. So we look forward to those speakers. And again, that's on Thursday, September the 20th, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at the Satellite Restaurant, 4,000 block of Jefferson Davis. This right here is just my alarm. If you call 646-1526, that's 646-1526, these firefighters will come to your home, your apartment, your business, and they will install this smoke alarm for you for free. It does not cost anything. So please give them a call so they can come to your home and install this. And also, if you need a battery, they will replace the battery at no cost to you. So please, please make sure that you call that number so you can have a smoke alarm, because they do save your life. Also at our meeting, our police department, the captain from 1st, 2nd, and 3rd will be at our meetings, and also the fire department. They come there and they give us good reports on different things that they're doing for our 8th district. So again, don't forget to come to the 8th district meeting on Thursday, September 20th. Thank you.
Thanks, Chairman. Ms. Eagle.
Clearly,
Street, 200 units, 75 teenagers, nothing to do. Nothing to do. There's no space even on their apartment complex to put a basketball court like that much up. They have money, tore it down, they made something else. It's a mess. Whatever's the case, we invite all comers who might have suggestions as to how those dollars can be spent, that we can take them from Mrs. Green, the principal, and the new principal over teaching. I also found out, and I think this might be instructive for most of us, that we're charging our peewees and midgets, football teams, players now, $25 per child. It has cut over half of the numbers down of kids playing ball. Some of these teams can't even man a team. They don't have the money this close to school opening to pay $25. This is brand new, no warning. And if I'm wrong, I'll take it on the job. But I got to make a feeling I'm not wrong about that. It came from a reliable source. Last year, this time, we had 1,800 kids who had already registered. We only have 780. This is ridiculous. Recreation ought to be as free, in my opinion, as law enforcement. And when we keep cutting it back, we do everybody a disservice. So, y'all look at your rec centers. You're going to be affected if this is true. And I urge you to fight like crazy. I think that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jervis Robinson.
Thank you, Madam President. First of all, I'd like to thank the Economic and Community Development staff for meeting with the 6th District this past Saturday. We had a very interesting discussion in regards to the proposed legislation that is before the council on derelict structures, which is the phase one to the total introduction of a package to put the receivership legislation also in place. So this is phase one of that. It was a very informative conversation. Very meaningful from the perspective of how we move forward with trying to address the blight in our communities. And so I would ask my colleagues that that legislation will probably be coming back before us at the next council meeting for some action. Also, I want to thank the citizens that have called in and for other council members that have put names in for the Affordable Housing Trust Fund. Hopefully we will be able to entertain those nominations for the trust fund and put that in place for the first meeting to be held no later than the first part of October, with an anticipation of some recommendation back from the administration identifying source of funding as early as January, so that we can plan to have an affordable housing trust fund in full operation by the next budget cycle. I'd also like to inform the residents that tomorrow is September the 11th, and appreciate the moment of prayer, the silence this afternoon, but there is several volunteer activities that are going on throughout the entire city. Paul Manning and his staff and volunteers have coordinated several groups to do lots of activities throughout the city. For the 6th District, we'll be having activity in the Bellmead community as well as in Holland Park on Valley Road and Cannon Creek next to the beautiful pedestrian bicycle trail that goes from Boston to Florida. that connects, yes. This is for Mr. George to remember that. The other thing that I would like to mention also is that we have begun work on the Dove Street redevelopment. We're in the process of first phase of construction there, as well as the redevelopment of the Matthew Heights site with single-family attached houses that are being built on that location. So I'd like to just put out a notice to the community that there will be a groundbreaking ceremony within the next 30 to 60 days for those developments that are now under construction. We will not be having a district meeting in the month of October for the same reasons that Mr. Hill has mentioned, due to our inability to circulate information during the election period of time. So we're not having that meeting in October. We'll have our next district meeting after the election of November. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Ms. Robertson. Just want to the people in the 4th District know there will be a cabinet forum on Wednesday, September 19th at the Westover Baptist Church. It's on Westerville's Boulevard. It's at 7. It'd be a good opportunity to get to know the candidates. It's being sponsored by Westover Hills Civic Association and Forest Hills Civic Association. There are 5 candidates for school board and 2 for city council. So probably worth everybody's while to come to that. If you can't make that one, there'll be another one the end of October, west of the Po White at St. Luke's Church. So you have an opportunity either time to see the candidates. Kids are back in school. I just wanted to give a little reminder. We're back in council. Be careful driving. I don't know if it's council people or school kids you're watching out for, but in any event, school is back in and we're back in, and please drive carefully. Tomorrow, out in front of City Hall, Marshall Street between 9th and 10th, we close to all traffic. This is become both entrance, this is for us or for anyone coming into City Hall. Both the entrance and exit ramps to City Hall, parking deck will be accessible. The City Hall deck traffic will be able to gain access to the entrance ramp via 10th Street and exit down 9th Street. The reason for this closure is due to 9/11 remembrance and service day activities, as Ms. Robertson mentioned. And again, tomorrow the event goes from 7:30 to 9, and or from 8:30 to 10. And the street will be closed from 7 to 10. And that's all I have. Member Burke, please read the introduction papers.
New legislation for this evening is as follows. Ordinance number 2012-159 to amend the city code concerning the city's tax amnesty program for the purpose of reflecting amendments as set forth in 2012 Virginia Acts, which establishes the city's tax amnesty program and authorizes the director of finance to administer and the city council and the mayor to provide parameters for such program. Council's Finance and Economic Development Standing Committee, September 20th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-160 to authorize the CAO to accept $2,500 from the VCU health system and to appropriate the increase to the Department of Social Services for the purpose of implementing and evaluating the health behavior intervention for women living in the city's East End. Council's Health, Human Services, and Education Standing Committee, September 19th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-161 to authorize the CAO to accept $53,161 from the Virginia Foundation for Healthy Youth and to appropriate the increase for the purpose of promoting breastfeeding among new mothers and physical activity among youth. Council's Health, Human Services, and Education Standing Committee, September 19th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-162 to authorize the CAO on behalf of the city to execute a letter agreement between the city and Norfolk Southern Corporation for the purpose of the city obtaining access to the railroad property and right-of-way to make repairs to the portion of the Manchester Bridge located over Norfolk Southern Corporation's railroad tracks and right-of-way. Council's Land Use, Housing and Transportation Standing Committee,
September 18th, council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-163, to amend ordinance number 80-260-81-41, concerning the Beaufort Oaks Community Unit Plan, to amend the permitted uses to include an adult care residential use, and to establish the number of permitted adult care resident dwelling units. Council's Land Use, Housing, and Transportation Standing Committee, September 18th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-164, to authorize the CAO to execute a construction agreement between the city and CSX Transportation, Inc. for the purpose of the city obtaining access to railroad property and right-of-way in order to make repairs to the portion of the Robert E. Lee Bridge located over CSX Transportation, Inc.'s railroad tracks and right-of-way. Council's Land Use, Housing, and Transportation Standing Committee, September 18th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-165, to authorize special use of 1517 West Carey Street for the purpose of a two-family detached dwelling. Council's Planning Commission, October 4th. Council's public hearing, October 8th. Ordinance number 2012-166, to declare a public necessity exists and to authorize the acquisition of permanent and temporary easements on 6001 and 6007 Hull Street Road for the purpose of the realignment of Hull Street Road, King Road, and Derwent Road. Council's Planning Commission, September 17th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-167, to authorize a special use of 2551 Monument Avenue for the purpose of a parking area to serve events occurring on the property known as 2501 Monument Avenue upon certain terms and conditions. Council's Planning Commission, October 1st. Council's public hearing date, October 8th. Ordinance number 2012-168, to amend ordinance number 2001-308-305, which authorizes the special use of the property known as 2501 Monument Avenue for the purpose of a museum for architecture with outdoor events, a reception facility, and out-of-print book dealer, and a lodging unit, to authorize the expansion of the number of types of permitted events upon certain terms and conditions. Council's Planning Commission, October 1st. Council's public hearing date, October 8th. Ordinance number 2012-168, to amend and ordain ordinance number 90-11-25, which authorizes special use of properties known as 7 through 13 West Franklin Street, 4 through 14 West Main Street, and 101 West Franklin Street as a parking area and a hotel for the purpose of authorizing outdoor dining areas upon certain terms and conditions. Council's public hearing date, October 1st. I'm sorry, Council's Planning Commission, October 1st. Council's public hearing date, October 8th. Ordinance number 2012-170, to authorize John G. Gavios and Josephine C. Flotomos to encroach upon the public right-of-way and to propose outdoor dining areas on the south line of West Broad Street between Mulberry Street and the Boulevard in front of 2701 West Broad Street. Council's Planning Commission, September 17th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-171, to authorize a CAO to execute a memorandum of understanding between the city, the school board of the city, and the Center for Neighborhood Enterprise for the purpose of the city making a grant for the Center of Neighborhood Enterprise for the continuation of the violence-free zone program at George Wythe High School and Armstrong High School. Council's Public Safety Standing Committee, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-172, to authorize the CAO to accept $67,500 from the Virginia Department of Criminal Justice Services and to transfer $7,500 to the FY 2012-13 General Fund Budget Department of Justice Services account and to appropriate the total amount of $75,000 to the Department of Justice Services for the purpose of engaging a criminal justice plan to establish a jail bed use plan and an alternative placement process. Council's Public Safety Standing Committee, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-173 to authorize a special use of 1322 West Broad Street for the purpose of a multifamily dwelling with up to 19 dwelling units and uses permitted in the B6 Mixed Use Business District upon certain terms and conditions. Council's Planning Commission, October 1st. Council's Public Hearing Date, October 8th. Ordinance number 2012-174 to declare a public necessity for and to authorize the acquisition of 1638, 1650, and 1700 Commerce Road for the purpose of housing the Department of Public Works Division of Fleet Management. Council's Planning Commission, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-175 to declare a public necessity for and to authorize the acquisition of 2007 Brook Road, 2009 A Brook Road, and 2011 Northumberland Avenue for the purpose of housing the facility management functions of the school board of the city of Richmond. Council's Planning Commission, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Ordinance number 2012-176 to transfer $3,451,986 from the FY 2012-13 general fund budget, $1,900 from the FY 2013 debt services fund budget, and $396,000 from the FY 2013 Department of Public Utilities Stores Internal Services Fund budget, and to amend the FY 2012-13 capital budget by appropriating such transferred funds in the total amount of $5,747,986 to the Boulevard Redevelopment Preparation Project in the Economic and Community Development category for the purpose of relocating city departments from locations owned by the city along the boulevard to locations that the city plans to acquire at 1636, 1650, and 1700 Commerce Road, 2007 and 2009 A Brook Road, and 2011 Northumberland Avenue. Council's Planning Commission, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R118 to provide for the nomination of Linda G. Brodemeyer, James M. Johnson, and Pierce R. Homer as the City of Richmond's three directors and the election of the Board of Directors of the Greater Richmond Transit Company for the period commencing upon election and terminating on the date of the 2013 Annual Meeting of Shareholders. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-119 to support a policy whereby the cold weather overflow shelter is kept open when the outdoor or windshield temperature falls to 40 degrees Fahrenheit or below, to request that the CAO determine the amount of funds needed to implement such a policy and to identify appropriate sources of city funds for the funds needed to implement such a policy, and to support the city's vision of a permanent housing for homeless persons. Council's Health Human Services Standing Committee, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R120 to approve the City of Richmond's plan of services under the Virginia Juvenile Community Crime Control Act. Council's Public Safety Standing Committee, September 17th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R121 to authorize an expenditure of $1,501 from the Council District Funds for the 5th District to pay Bokey Tronite Trophies, Inc. for trophies in the 4th Annual Ray Neblett Intercity Basketball Camp hosted by the Ray Neblett Intercity Basketball. Council's Finance and Economic Development Standing Committee, September 20th. Council's Public Hearing Date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R122 to appropriate $2,000 from the Council District Funds for the 5th District to the Department of Parks, Recreation, and Community Facilities to purchase pads and drills for the Pee Wee and Midget Ralph Community Center football team and uniforms for the Randolph Senior Girls Cheerleader Squad. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R123 to appropriate an expenditure in the amount of $625 from the council district funds for the 9th district to pay for meals, meal preparation, and the use of facilities for the 9th district community meeting on October 23rd. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R124 to approve an expenditure in the amount of $625 from the council district funds for the 9th district to pay for meals preparation and use of facilities for the 9th district community meeting on September 25th, 2012. Council's public hearing date, September 24th, 2012. Resolution number 2012-R125 to approve an expenditure in the amount of $625 from the council district funds for the 9th district to pay for meals, meal preparation, and the use of facilities for the 9th district community meeting on November 20th, 2012. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Resolution 2012-R126 to approve the Richmond Behavioral Health Authority's performance contract. Council's Health Human Services Standing Committee meeting, September 19th. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Resolution number 2012-R127 to approve the mayor's appointment of Michael J. Scholl as a member of the Board of Directors of the Richmond Metropolitan Authority, succeeding David P. Baugh. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. And last but not least, resolution number 2012-R128. To approve the mayor's appointment of Marilyn H. West as a member of the Board of Directors of the Richmond Metropolitan Authority, succeeding Beverly A. Burton. Council's public hearing date, September 24th. Madam President, this is all new legislation that I have this evening.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. This meeting is...
Madam President, we have... I had disqualified Mr. Jewell because he left early this evening. The next person in line on the time of leaving is Mr. Tyler at 9:30. Congratulations, Mr. Tyler.
Mr. Tyler, I never knew you were such an optimist.
Absolutely. You'd be surprised if you talked to me.
I